Okay, so good afternoon, everyone, to those who are here in person and those of us who are joining online. We at Amsterdam Center for International Law, ACIL, are very pleased to welcome Tom Ginsburg, who comes from the University of Chicago, where he is Leo Spitz Professor of International Law, Ludwig and Hilde Research Scholar and Professor of Political Science. Tom focuses on comparative and international law from an interdisciplinary perspective, as you can very well see also from this book that he will be talking about today. So apart from his teaching duties, he also works with numerous international development agencies and foreign governments on legal and constitutional reform. He also co-directs the Comparative Constitutions Project, an effort funded by the National Science Foundation to gather and analyze the constitutions of all independent nation states since 1789. So without further ado, let's welcome Tom for his talk on democracies and international law.
Thank you. Thank you. Those of you who are here in person, you get bonus points. And everyone online, thanks so much for tuning in for this talk. This is about a book that is literally just coming out in the United States. It was published last week and I was already on the road, so I haven't even seen a physical copy of this book called Democracies in International Law. And I adopt that title quite intentionally. That is, there's a large literature on, I guess what you'd call the democracy of international law, the global governance, global administrative law, trying to make international legal institutions more democratic, values of participation, that kind of thing. And there's also a literature on the international law of democracy. And in particular, I use as a kind of a foil, the famous argument from the 1990s that there might even be a right to democratic governance by Thomas Frank, which I, as you'll see, don't agree with. I don't think that's a good way to think about the project for various reasons. But what I wanted to do is look at how democracies actually behave in international law. What do they actually do? So how do democracies use international law? Is it different from authoritarian regimes and what I call authoritarian international law? And so that's what this book tries to cover. You know, just to start with, I'll just make some preliminary comments. The first thing everyone needs, let's see, this thing is frozen. The first thing anyone needs in a, if you're gonna talk about democracy is, you know, well, what do you mean by democracy? Because that's obviously a contested term. So the definition I'm using in this project is one that is drawn from prior work I did with my colleague Aziz Haq. We wrote a book 2-3 years ago called How to Save a Constitutional Democracy, which is very much focused on the problem of democratic backsliding that is pervading the world these days. And one of the questions I ask in this book is whether international law can do anything about that. You know, is it sort of helping or hurting the effort to secure a domestic democracy? So what's our definition? Well, we have kind of what we'd call a thin, relatively thin definition. There's a million definitions of democracy. Every definition of democracy has elections at its core. Elections in which, you know, the loser concedes power and that are ex ante uncertain, to quote Adam Jaworski. That's basic. And a lot of political scientists just use that. But as lawyers, as constitutional lawyers, we thought, well, that's not good enough. That is, you can't really have a competitive election unless you also have certain core rights. Not the entire panoply of human rights and social and economic rights, all that stuff. But you at least need rights to, you know, speak freely, criticize the government, organize, demonstrate, right to vote. Core rights that are really tied to elections, we include in our definition. And then we include something that we call the bureaucratic rule of law. What do we mean by that? Well, if you think about it, you can't really have an election unless you have people who are gonna count the votes in a neutral way, you know, without regard to political favor, right? And we take that for granted. But it's really important, especially in this era of democratic backsliding. You still have countries like, you know, Turkey, where Erdogan could lose an election. And he actually re-ran the election for the mayorship of Istanbul because he lost the first time he ran again. He still lost in that, you know, backsliding pseudo-authoritarian country. So the fact that you still have autonomous bureaucrats is really an important resource. It's especially important for democracy because what's, you know, if you think about what is democracy, it's the idea that the governments fall and the regime stays. And that sort of depends in some sense on a neutral bureaucracy, a civil service that will do the bidding of whoever happens to be elected. And the reason it depends on that is if you could totally politicize the bureaucracy, as people from Donald Trump to Erdogan to Hugo Chavez try to do, if you could politicize it, then when you lose an election, it's not just you losing the election, it's, you know, millions of civil servants in the United States. And that means you never give, would give up power. The stakes are too high if you can control millions and millions of, you know, appointments. So in some sense, having a bureaucrats who follow the rule of law in some ideal sense is core and constitutive of democracy. So that's our definition. Now I'll say that it happens to coincide more or less with the definition of democracy we can distill from the international human rights instruments, the definition in the Universal Declaration and the International Covenant of Civil and Political Rights focuses, you know, Article 21 of the first and Article 25 of the second are basically identical. Everyone has the right to participate in public affairs. Everyone has the right to vote and be elected in a free election. And everyone has access to public service, the public service. And that's probably conceived of as kind of a non-discrimination principle, but we see in that also an implication that the public service is a neutral body, right? Not partisan in some sense. So you can see our thin definition is somewhat like the definition in international law. Now you notice though that this is it's in the human rights instruments, implying that there might be a right to democracy. And this, of course, is what Thomas Frank proposed in the early 1990s, that democracy itself was actually a right. I don't think that's a good way of thinking about it. I think it conflates rights with democracy. And if some rights are a component of democracy, well, then you're mixing up two different things. There's a strong reason that we should reject the idea that there's a universal right to democratic governance. First of all, democracy empirically is not feasible in every country. It requires certain preconditions, wealth, education, and we just know this from the comparative study of democracy. And another powerful reason, and that, so that means, you know, to say that everyone has a right to be free from torture is in principle achievable in every country of the world. But to say that everyone has a right to democratic governance is not achievable at the current state of affairs. Furthermore, you know, I guess I rely on a much more traditional view of international law as trying to organize, you know, very distinct kinds of political systems that do not overlap. I don't think it's possible that the world would converge around one particular, you know, vision of how to run a country. So that's one important reason not to. The other thing, of course, is that if half the countries in the world are violating this fundamental right, well, that means they're possibly, you know, illegitimate members of the international community. It underlines the core principles of international law as a mechanism for dealing with difference. And of course, there are plenty of core principles I'm sure you're familiar with, which reiterate that, right? The UN Charter saying that, you know, there's no threats of force, there's no interference in matters of the domestic jurisdiction. And also, I guess I'd cite the 1970 Friendly Relations Declaration, for those who know that, that there's a strong stream in international law of non-interference, of let sovereign nations be independent. Now, I started by motivating this study with a story of two elections that occurred in 2016. This guy here is a man named Yahya Jammeh. He was the longtime dictator of the Gambia, a tiny nation in West Africa, completely surrounded by Senegal. And Jammeh had taken power in a coup in the mid-1990s, and he kept having elections, and his victory margin just kept going up. And, you know, he was a garden variety dictator. In 2016, he ran an election, and surprising everybody, he lost. He actually lost to a guy who just won re-election last week in the Gambia. So, well, this was a kind of moment. Is this kind of autocratic system going to democratize? Jammeh initially said, yeah, I will acknowledge the people's will. But then he changed his mind and he started mobilizing the troops. And what happened? All the nations in blue here are members of a regional trade bloc, the Economic Community of West African States, ECOWAS, and they have in their democracy, you know, architecture, they have a principle that, you know, you can't sort of indirectly, they have a principle that you can't have unconstitutional changes in government. You have to acknowledge elections, good governance. And even though many of those states are not themselves very strong democracies, they mobilized and they said to Jammeh, you have to go. You can't do that. can't have an election and fail to acknowledge it. And he made some noises. The UN Security Council actually passed a resolution about this, and Senegal's troops massed on the border, and a week later, Jammeh was gone, and he fled. So that's a good story of international law promoting and protecting, in some sense, democracy, democratic governance. Where did he go? He went to the home country of this guy, Mr. Obiang, who is the president of Equatorial Guinea, tiny nation over here, I guess, which is Africa's richest country in per capita terms and has probably among the lowest development indicators. Why? Because it's an oil state. Obiang and his son, Obiang and his family basically control the entire economy. Also had an election that year, Obiang, in which he won by 85%, he had 85% support. The principal opposition guy was in jail. The international community did nothing and said nothing. Which is it? Is there kind of, which vision of international law is dominant here? The pro-democratic, pro-rights, pro-turnover, or the non-interference sovereignty promoting one? Obiang, for those who are international lawyers, will be well known to you because of the immunities case at the ICJ, by the way, where it found that his son, even though the son was the vice president, couldn't have his stolen wealth in, that France could legitimately exercise jurisdiction over that. So in any case, there's these two visions and they are in some tension, obviously. Now, the question is, will democracies be different in international? That's what I want to start with. Are democracies different? And I guess my general inclination in much of my work is to not simply sort of reason from abstract principles, but to see how the world actually works and to use that to inform our normative kind of suppositions and statements about how the world should be organized. And there's strong theoretical reasons to think that democracies would be different and would be more inclined to use international law in a very deep way. And that's kind of an empirical investigation. I'll show you whether that's true. But theoretically, why would that be the case? If you were a dictator like Obiang, your time horizon is your own political survival, maybe your son. But your government is completely coextensive with the regime as a whole. If the regime falls, you're done. And you could lose a lot if that happens, not just your wealth, but possibly your life. And so there's a lot at stake for these guys and their time horizon is limited. In democracies, if you think about it, democracy depends on the government and the regime being different. The only thing you know as a democratic leader is that you will leave power. And when you leave power, you will keep your wealth and your life what democracies do is lower the stakes of politics, right? By making sure that losers can safely walk away. Now, what does that mean for international law? Because democratic governments know that their time horizons are limited, but that their commitments, their regimes will last a long time. It's makes a lot of sense for them to try to make commitments on the international plane that will outlast the government, right? Of course, in international law, it's states that are committed under the law of state responsibility, all that stuff, and not governments. So if a government makes a promise, that is in principle enduring. And a government that knows it's going to leave power can get credibility by doing that, by making promises on the international plane. So that's really important. Another core difference between democracies and dictatorships is that democracies, we like to think, the democratic government will be reelected as long as it's doing things for the mass of citizenry, right? It is concerned in principle with the majority of citizens. It wants to create what we call in economics public goods, right? Things like national defense and free markets and environmental protection, these kind of things, which everyone can enjoy. That's the principle of reason for government, I suppose. Now, if you're in a dictatorship, your main concern is political survival. And that means that you may be a little less interested in true public goods than you are in goods that can be segmented and given mainly to your supporters, right? And that might mean that you have less propensity to want to create transnational public goods, right? So let me just explain that to be clear, because I'm using language which may be unfamiliar to you. Two states that share a river, right, between them. The management of that water resource is a public good as between the two of them. It requires cooperation. And that requires that you can't do that within the borders of the state. You need to cooperate with international law in order to get that done. states in Europe obviously do a lot of this. The whole European Union is a giant, you know, free market and to some degree a security regime, which is, in other words, giving the citizens of all those individual countries more of those things than they would have if they were just limited to the country as a whole. So it's a kind of mechanism, international law is a mechanism for creating these public goods. Authoritarians, of course, like those things too, but again, they want to segment benefits. And they also are going to be extremely risk averse when it comes to commitments. If Holland loses a case before the European Court of Justice, no government is going to fall on it, right? You pay the price and, you know, it's fine. If you are a dictatorship, though, you're really concerned with surprises. You want things to be as predictable as possible. And the idea that, you know, you could commit to some international court that then you might lose a case before could, you know, be the basis of some domestic uprising and things like this. And so there's kind of a sense in which third party dispute resolution is a little more risky for authoritarians, I think. The final difference, I think, in theory is that democracies tend to require, as a result of their domestic governance, transparency. So you make commitments, you make them publicly, the people can see. Dictatorships don't really value publicity because they actually don't want their commitments necessarily to be known by all their citizens. They want to carefully manage which things are going out to the public and which do not. And if you think about international treaties in particular, when you sign a treaty and put it, you know, deposit it with the United Nations, it's publicly available. Everyone knows what commitments you're making. So that means for a dictator, you may want to be less precise with those commitments. You might want to make fewer of them and to do your deals in a much softer, less binding way, less transparent way. So that's kind of the theory. What do we find? Well, what I do in the first part of the book is look at the entire range of international legal behavior, I guess you call it, treaty making, adjudication before international tribunals, like the Law of the Sea Tribunal, the International Court of Justice, et cetera. Participation in things like the International Law Commission, sort of technocratic areas where international law gets made. And what I find in all of these areas is that the democracies are much more likely to participate than our dictatorships. This figure here divides democracies, and I can talk about the measurement of democracy. I'm using political science indices. This is some so-called VDEM index, into five buckets, low and high. The highest 20% of democracies, and the bar is how many treaties they have in force in any given year. And you can see that treaties are a feature of very highly democratic countries, much more likely than other types. I then looked at the United Nations treaty series and looked at bilateral treaties, treaties between two countries. And here my concern is, what's the nature of the, I guess we call it the dyad, the pair of countries? Are they both democratic? Are they both dictatorships? Or are they mixed? And in this period, I should say, in the entire period of my study after 1945, about 40% of country years, like the baseline level is about 40% of democratic country years. So, we should expect, if all things were equal, you know, I guess in this case, for a jointly democratic dyad, for democracy making a treaty with a democracy, that should be about 16% of the data. What do we find is 64% of the treaties. Whereas authoritarian dyads, two dictatorships, only have 2% deposited in the United Nations. Now it's possible those countries are making secret treaties. But in a way, that sort of illustrates the theory that they want to keep things secret. They don't want public commitments. And I also look at the probabilities. It's about, you know, and roughly 20 times as probable in any given year that two democracies will conclude a treaty as would two dictatorships. So that's some evidence. I also looked at countries which are very common, certain kind of country where they're switching back and forth between being a dictatorship and a democracy during the post-war period. Turkey is really a classic one here. It's always going back and forth. But there are others like Ukraine and Venezuela, I guess, has gone back and forth. And what I do here is I look at those countries specifically and I ask, what was the probability that they would make a treaty during a period they were democratic, as opposed to when they were a dictatorship, non-democracy? And in this one, I'm controlling for wealth, because we know wealthy countries probably would make more treaties. There's more possible public goods to create. but also for how many neighbors you have. If you think about it, right, Holland has, you know, more neighbors than, well, I'll use Luxembourg, that's easy. Luxembourg has more neighbors than the United States, right? So that means that they have more need to cooperate internationally, right? There's more benefit, I suppose, to them. What do we find is that controlling for those factors, and just to read it to you, you're more than twice as likely, if you want such a country, to conclude a treaty any time you're democratic. So that's another strong bit of evidence that it's the mechanism of democracy and not some characteristic of the country that is really driving it. Then I looked at adjudication, and this is just the International Court of Justice. For those in the room, I'll just highlight very simply. About 40% of all years are democratic. 60% of all ICJ cases are filed by democracies. And this is an interesting one because we're now seeing, and I'll get to this a little bit further, more dictatorships filing cases. Qatar, for example, has filed a bunch of cases under the racial discrimination treaty. Dictatorships are sort of learning, but for the overall effect, very democratic skew. For other tribunals, the Law of the Sea Tribunal in Hamburg, I think they've had 25 cases, only two were filed by non-democratic states. So it's a really significant thing that democracies are willing to adjudicate more. And I won't go through all the evidence in the other things, but you can take my word for it that if you look at the amount of time spent on the International Law Commission, who's making speeches, who's making interventions, it's citizens of democratic countries, or it's the representatives of democratic countries. Final adjudication point is actually investor-state dispute resolution. And this one, so I look at whether the claimant comes from a democracy. Remember, in this kind of area of international law, there's private citizens suing states. So is the respondent state a democracy or dictatorship, and where's the claimant come from? And just looking at the probabilities of making a claim, citizens of democracies are much more likely to claim either against, especially against another democracy, but also against a dictatorship than are citizens of autocracies. So significant skew. Now, things are changing. And I've been thinking now for a couple of years about something I'm calling authoritarian international law. And I'm actually gonna, before I talk about the slide, read you a quote from Jiang Zemin, president of China in 1996. He said, "Our leaders and cadres, especially of those of high rank, ought to take note of international law and enhance their skills in it. We must become adept at international law, using it as a weapon to defend the interests of our state and maintain national pride." And I'd argue that that's something China began to take very seriously and has now become extremely adept at. And so that we are learning, they are learning. And of course, China's not alone. In my work on national constitutions around the world, one of our findings is that most innovations in governance, most new ideas come from democracies. You know, so like a new right, for example, right to privacy, or a new institution, counter-corruption commission, human rights commissions. These are invented by democracies. But what we learn in that area is that authoritarians see the democratic innovation and gradually adopt those things, of course, with a very different purpose, right? Rights in a dictatorship have a very different political purpose than rights in a democracy. And you could say, well, they're trying to sort of water down the meaning of these things or just use it for their own ends. We're seeing that in international law too. And so this leads to the demand for what I call authoritarian international law, legal behavior designed to extend the survival and reach of authoritarian rule across time or space. And maybe I'll first talk about the learning and then I'll talk about the features. So, what I'm finding is mimicry for sure, but then gradually using these things in actually a very serious way, in ways that have a different kind of political logic than they would in democracies, but they're becoming very useful for authoritarians. So I start with the Cold War period in which you had the Warsaw Pact, right? The Warsaw Pact was basically, if you look at it, just a copy of the NATO treaty, almost, clause by clause. And whereas the NATO treaty, there was sort of had a life, there were amendments to it, it was actually invoked in 2001. The Warsaw Pact was obviously a fig leaf, right? It didn't you know, the common defense was not about defense of the, of, you know, against external enemies. The common defense was to prevent internal countries like the Czech Republic, like Hungary, from leaving the communist fold. And that's where force was used in the Warsaw Pact. Then I also talk about the kind of sovereignty reinforcing principles, not really, you know, inherently authoritarian, but used a lot by authoritarians, beginning at Bandung with the so-called non-aligned movement, China and India and such, trying to build up their state capacity. But now that is being really, you know, that used to sort of prevent sort of interference with internal affairs. In the last two decades, we've seen really the development of authoritarian institutionalized regimes. The Eurasian Economic Community, which is mimicking, again, the architecture of the European Union. It's got exactly the same structure of a council and a commission, all the things you're familiar with. They have that in the Eurasian Economic Community. And, you know, it's, I think, has a very important political purpose for Putin and Russia, which is to signal that Eurasia is its own security zone, that it is a zone of mutual, you know, respect, and they should, and of course, countries that try to move too much towards Europe, see the Ukraine, are encouraged to join this thing instead. It's a counterweight. So that's a political purpose. The Shanghai Cooperation Organization is something that when it first appeared in the early 2000s, people like me said, ah, that's just a fig leaf. There's nothing going on there. But it has been used to articulate a new set of international norms, international law norms. So it focuses, first of all, it's very much a unanimity-based organization. It's not majority voting or anything like that. States are not giving up sovereignty in these authoritarian international organizations. But the organizations are being used to articulate new norms on the international plane. So in the Shanghai Cooperation Organization, it's focused heavily on what it calls the three evils: terrorism, separatism, and extremism. And I argue that, you know, terrorism obviously does have a kind of meaning of some sort on the international plane, but separatism and extremism are really new concepts. And if they're regionally prohibited, and the organization is trying to embed them actually at the level of the UN as well, that's a pretty significant change in international law. The so-called law of external self-determination, the kind of Kosovo type of exceptions, those things are not feasible if you've got separatism, if even raising the possibility of breaking away is now an international crime. What it means in practice is that those countries in the Shanghai Cooperation Organization will extradite each other's dissidents across borders and really constrain political space internally for the benefit of all of the currently sitting regimes. Authoritarian international law, in my view, is very Westphalian in terms of its rhetoric. You know, I have an older article on Asia, where I say that East Asian international law is Eastphalian, by which I mean, it's very much like traditional Westphalian. Independent states, no interference in our internal affairs, sovereignty is super important. But the authoritarian international law we're seeing now is, I think, very focused on internal security rather than external. There's some slight interesting rhetorical shifts. So instead of the rule of law on the international plane, the international rule of law, which you begin to hear from Western countries in the 1990s, they have the rule of international law with the Security Council at the very center of that. And of course, that's really good if you're Russia and China. The rule of international law means non-interference unless their Security Council approval, which is very rare and, you know, maybe fine as a rule, but I just point out the rhetorical shift to reinforce a vision of international law against the human rights oriented vision that comes out of Europe and every once in a while from the United States. I think what we see is less reliance on third party dispute resolution, less delegation international organizations, less majoritarian decision-making in those international organizations. Well, one of the things I've been working on, actually it's my next big project, is to look at international organization charters. So I have about 500 charters of international organizations. And what I can do, or what we've done, is to characterize international organizations as by the level of democracy of the countries that are members at any one time. And so what this figure shows is the percentage of members in the international organization that are Democrat, you know, democracies versus non-democracies. And so here are international organizations that are made up entirely of dictatorships. And here are international organizations made up entirely of democracies. And that's rather interesting. I was surprised by this. You see that it's bimodal. They're about the same number of those things, meaning that we're now seeing authoritarian countries collaborate in ways to advance particular agendas. All right, so, you know, I'm a scholar of East Asia, among other things. And so, you know, this the rise of China is something that I think obviously is at the very center of the authoritarian international law project. China's been very now engaged with international law at the UN, at the Human Rights Committee, and trying to promote its own vision. China, of course, also asserts that it is doing so and it has no problem with democracy. Some of you may know that, I guess, tomorrow there's going to be something called a Summit of Democracies that Joe Biden has put together, where all the democracies will get together. It's not sure what if it's really so meaningful, but it's a nice attempt to kind of get democracies together. This week, China put out a statement saying it's their annual critique of American democracy, in which they say, actually, democracy is a universal good. All countries value democracy. We value democracy. Of course, you can't tell us what kind of democracy we're going to have. And then the report goes on to list all these criticisms of American democracy, many of which are actually quite accurate. But it's a kind of a funny thing that that rhetoric, in other words, is getting watered down. If, hey, you know, if China's, if North Korea is, after all, the Democratic People's Republic of Korea, that shows you, in some sense, the rhetorical power of democracy, but also how you can water down the term if you want to. Now, I won't go too much into the Belt and Road thing, except that it is very much a very different vision of international law than what you have here in Europe. Europe is obviously the center of, you know, deep multilateralism, right? And the One Belt, One Road sort of structure in international law is very much a kind of hub and spoke system, we would say, bilateral treaties where each country has an individual relationship with China. And, you know, there's a lot of good things coming out of it. I'm not someone who's sort of thinks it's you know, some kind of new imperial thing. I also will note, and this is something that I hope that people in Washington recognize, that China is perfectly compatible, you know, its investment and its engagement are perfectly compatible with countries remaining democracies. In other words, it's not like the old Soviet Union, where trying to convert all countries to a Chinese system or something like that. That would be impossible anyway. Chinese system is really very, very unique. Nevertheless, I do think that the One Belt, One Road and does have a tendency to undermine certain democratic systems unintentionally, if you will. And that is because, you know, what do you want if you're an investor, outbound investment from China? What do you want? You want security. You have your investment, right? And that means you want someone, a local partner who you can trust that will be there for a while. Again, you have countries like Mongolia. It's been a democracy now for 30 years, right on China's border. That's tolerable. But I think there's this kind of tendency, certainly when you have vast amounts of money coming in, that obviously tends to lead to corruption, which tends to undermine democratic governance. And we have seen, particularly in South Asia, a couple of cases where Chinese are actually interfering in elections in Sri Lanka, in the Maldives, saying, you know, we want this guy, we want this dictator to stick around. I think they'll probably learn, but maybe not. And that means that this is a potential challenge for democracies of the world. When I wrote this a couple of years ago, really now, you know, I don't think it was so much on the radar, but just this month, the European Union announced a kind of counterweight to the One Belt, One Road investment coming from Europe. So democracies are waking up a little bit to the need, to the public good, if I can use the term, of global democracy. That is the idea that we benefit in democracies from having other democracies. All right, so what do we do? What's the normative conclusion of all of this? Well, I'm all for, you know, democracies getting together as in the summit this week. That's a good thing. I do think we do have a common interest in democracy in other countries. And that's also empirically informed. We know that democracies don't go to war with each other, for example. Democracies trade with each other more. And there's a cultural flow that happens much more freely among democracies. So it's good for every democracy to want other countries to be democracies. On the other hand, I wouldn't be so naive as to think that we could have some sort of new cold war of democracies against dictatorships. It's not feasible, in part because democracies have lots of other interests besides the democracy in other countries, right? They have investment relationships, there's environmental issues, there's lots of reasons that we would, that democracy might not be the highest priority for democracies in their international behavior. I do think though, and particularly this is really directed at the United States, and was written, of course, I started the project in a time when the United States had fully turned away from most international, most of the post-war liberal order under the Trump administration, that we ought to be much more engaged in preserving places which are democratic. These regional democracy charters, the international architecture for democracy, which exists in Latin America, in West Africa and East Africa, is really important, makes a difference on the ground. And we should do everything we can to support that. We should not, obviously, I call this kind of democracy support preservative. Preserve the space for democracy, maybe offer some carrots to move in that direction. But you can't obviously impose democracy at the end of a gun. And that's a lesson I think we finally learned in the United States. But that doesn't mean we can do nothing, right? I also think that there's some things which might benefit from cooperation across the democracy authoritarian divide. Corruption, right, is a cancer on every form of government. And even though many authoritarian regimes are deeply, deeply corrupt, they still have an interest in ending the channels of corruption which exist all over the world. I'm thinking of the, you know, the various small countries where you can deposit your ill-gotten gains. And it's a tough thing to do to end those, you know, those islands of impunity. But there may be a common interest. China doesn't want its dissidents and its, you know, leaders to siphon money out of the country either. So there may be some room for cooperation on that important democracy promoting tool. I also think, and this is again advice that seems obvious now, but you know, the prior administration in the United States basically gave up on the United Nations, right? On the Human Rights Commission, saying, oh, it's a bunch of dictatorships. None of this cooperation matters for ideological reasons. And that's deeply, deeply wrong. We have to obviously engage and fight. A good example there is the UN Convention on the Cyber Convention, cyber governance, that is being promoted at the UN to replace something called the Budapest Convention, which is a Council of Europe document to ensure cyber security, but in line with human rights provisions. And Russia and China have sponsored an alternative version of that that says nothing about human rights, that is very statist in its orientation. And so that's something where I think, well, you know, obviously we do need state capacity, but I suggest that the Western powers should really be very defensive about that and prevent that project from moving forward to make sure that whatever happens at the United Nations is not going to be simply reinforcing dictatorship. And there are many stories I could tell about resolutions that were, you know, where you would think there would be agreement among democracies, but because of China's economic power, we're seeing a lot of defection in that regard. A big lesson, and maybe this is the big punchline of the book, if democracies are more likely to use international law, well, and that's creating good things for the citizens of democracies, well, that means international law is good for democracy just in its general form, right? That is, if you're cooperating on trade or environment or things like that, citizens of democracies benefit. And that requires, of course, then re-engaging with the international law architecture. And I think is something that that even if there is not a right to democratic governance, international law still indirectly supports, reinforces democratic governance by delivering to the citizens of democracies public goods, things that they otherwise couldn't get. Finally, I note that whatever happens with the United States, whatever happens with China, there are many sort of mid-ranking countries, mid-level countries, which is really where the action is, in my view. United States and China are going to do their thing, and their, you know, interaction is going to shape the environment to a large degree. But it is also the case that we observe all kinds of good developments in smaller countries. And even though there's kind of a bad mood right now in terms of the direction of democratic backsliding, and it's going to continue probably for a bit longer because Democratic backsliding happens a lot when people are just in a bad mood and sour, and the COVID thing hasn't helped and such. And so there's like not a lot of, you know, hey, three cheers for democracy kind of stuff out there. Nevertheless, it will end because I think, do believe, there's a universal demand actually for some of the things which are found in democracy, the ability to participate, the ability to speak your mind. And we're seeing, and I'll just end with this, in very places you might not expect, nice, interesting things happening in democratic governance. This country here is Malawi, tiny country in Africa. And during COVID, the leader had probably stolen an election. And the court in that country said, no, you have to rerun the election. There's too many irregularities. Then when COVID hit, he said, well, I know we were supposed to have an election, but it's COVID. We can't have an election. And the court actually stepped up and said, not only do you have to have the election, but you can't even have a lockdown because that would interfere with opposition's ability to organize. And in the end, he did have that election. He lost and he stepped down. That's a remarkable thing. To me, it says something about something very important going on in Africa, which is the importance of the discourse of law in constraining power, of which international law and these regional institutions are a major part. This is Armenia, country obviously in the, you know, this is the border between NATO and basically Russian troops. There's Russian troops there. And yet Armenia had a democratic revolution in 2018. They're consolidating that. Russia's tolerating that as long as they're not, you know, moving the security stuff in, you know, too far in a pro-Western direction. So, you know, that's a remarkable story too. And it shows that there is space for democratic governance notwithstanding the shift away from it in the core countries. Finally, this is the Sudan, which just had another coup last month, I guess, a couple months, and you know, it had a coup 2 years ago to throw out Omar al-Bashir, the butcher of Darfur, if I can use the term. Now, it's a messy situation. After the first coup, in accordance with African Union law, Sudan was suspended. And that meant that they were unable to, you know, participate in AU activities. And the AU, which is not majority democracies, made sure that in order to be readmitted, that government, the military government, had to work with the citizens who were on the streets. And they formed a kind of uneasy, maybe unstable partnership. And that has happened again last month. Now, who knows what's going to end up happening? But my submission is that without this regional law, without the regional norm against unconstitutional changes in government, the situation would be a lot worse, right? Omar al-Bashir was much more brutal than what's happened in the last 2 years. So that there is this kind of sense in which states around you, and particularly at the regional level, can do a lot of good in terms of making things better off. Now, you know, some regions of the world don't have it, but those that do really ought to be reinforced. Okay, that's it for, that's about all I have to say. I'm happy to take questions. Besides this book, by the way, the talk is brought to you by this podcast I just started. It's called Entitled. My podcast is Entitled, which is probably a good description of me as an American law professor. And I'm, but check it out. It's all about rights around the world. And so it's international law and comparative as well at the same time. So that's what I have to say. Love to hear any questions you have or any comments or corrections.